The next entity I'm going to talk about is paraneoplastic pemphigus. So paraneoplastic pemphigus, it is an autoimmune disease where it is characterized by autoantibodies to epidermal antigens. There is recalcitrant blisterin, mucocutaneous lesions, as well as an underlying neoplasm. The neoplasm most commonly associated with paraneoplastic pemphigus is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and Castleman's tumor. So in paraneoplastic pemphigus, we often see oropharyngeal blistering, recalcitrant oral pharyngeal blistering, and also along the vermilion border of the lips. In skin lesions, they might resemble erythema multiforme, toxic epidermal necrolysis, pemphigus vulgaris, or bullous pemphigoid. And this is the entity of paraneoplastic pemphigus. All of these combined compromise the pemphigus group of disorders. Now I'm going to talk about investigations as well as the treatment. So in investigations, a simple bedside investigation that we can do is a Zang smear. So in a Zang smear, we kind of remove a remnant part of the blister, drain the fluid, and with a blunt edge of a scalpel, we scrape the floor of the blister, put it on a slide, microscopic slide, and stain it with GMSA. So we see a Zang cell. Once if it's a Zang smear is positive, so a Zang cell is a large round keratinocyte with a high nuclear to cytoplasmic ratio. The cytoplasm is condensated around the periphery, and around the nucleus there's a perinuclear hollow, and this is known as a mounting edge cell. So this is a simple bedside investigation that we can do in order to confirm the diagnosis. Histopathologically in pemphigus, we see epidermal cells which are separated from each other due to acantholysis, but they're still attached to the basement membrane. And this is known as, like, when you look at it in a histopathological slide, we see like a intraepidermal blister. And because the epidermal cells are separated from each other but still attached to the basement membrane, the appearance that we see is a row of tombstone appearance. And we also do an immunofluorescence. In immunofluorescence, we see an IgG pattern, often in a fishnet kind of appearance, and the green immunofluorescence, which is classic for pemphigus group of disorders. And next, coming to the treatment, we do treatment according to the disease severity. We classify the disease based on the area of involvement as well as the discomfort to the patient into mild, moderate, and severe disease. In mild disease, often topical therapy is enough. We can even give topical corticosteroids which are potent, like such as clobetasol or halobetasol. We can also give topical tacrolimus or epidermal growth factors and other symptomatic treatment. And in moderate disease, systemic corticosteroids are often the mainstay of treatment. Often, if it's a moderate disease without that much of discomfort to the patient, or if it's not that severe, then often the dose is about 60 to 80 mg per day. If it's a very severe disease, then we're looking at doses of 80 to 120 mg per day. And we often, based on the response of the patient, we increase the doses by about 40% every 4 to 7 days. And this is how the dose increment is done. And once the lesions have resolved, we decrease the dose by 50% every 2 weeks. So this is the general protocol that we follow. Another special way to treat the disease, in order to prevent giving the patient a high dose of steroids regularly, like every day, we can give high dose of steroids to the patient once a month. So this is known as a DCP, which stands for dexamethasone cyclophosphamide pulse therapy. In DCP, there are 4 phases: phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and phase 4. In phase 1, we give 100 mg of dexamethasone intravenously, which is mixed in 500 ml of 5% dextrose, and this is given for about 3 consecutive days. In day 2, we add about 500 mg of cyclophosphamide 2, and the patient is also given oral cyclophosphamide about 50 mg every day. The duration of phase 1 is variable. It is often till the lesions are completely resolved and the patient is off corticosteroids. So the phase 1 varies from person to person. In phase 2, it's basically the patient has no more new lesions, but we still continue DCP for about 9 more months. In phase 3, it's about after we stop corticosteroids altogether and we give cyclophosphamide 50 mg for about 9 months. And phase 4 is a disease-free, a drug-free period where we just observe the patient if they have any new lesions or not. So this is a DCP cycle that we can also think about as a treatment alternative. We can also give other immunosuppressants in pemphigus patients, and these include methotrexate, azathioprine, cyclosporin, mycophenolate mofetil, IVIG, and also various biologicals can be thought of. So this in total compromises the pemphigus group of disorders.